Welcome to our Savior's Corner of Hope. We're glad you're here. This is a Communion Sunday, and we're looking forward to a great worship service. As we worship today, this is our last Sunday before the church reopens next week on the 14th of June. And on that week, it's possible for us to have at least 25% occupancy, which is going to accommodate us. So if you're interested in attending, you're welcome to come and join us. We will be sitting with some social distance between us, but we'll still worship God as a congregation. So we invite you to come and join us June 14th as we begin worshiping together on a regular basis. We will still stream the service, but we won't record it ahead of time. We'll just stream the service live. So we hope you'll join us next week. As we begin today, let's sing our opening song.
Here. course to enjoy, and you sustain it. Every day the sun comes up, and every night the moon comes up. We thank you so much for your faithfulness, Lord. Because without you, all of us would fall apart. And Father, as human beings, we do fall apart sometimes. We look at our world and our country right now, it's in turmoil. And we just ask that you would heal us as a land and as a people, that our country would turn back to you, that we would repent of our sins, Lord, and that we would follow you with our whole hearts. We know, Lord, that as your people, we need to follow you first. Give us wisdom in what you want us to do and heal us of our sins. Forgive us, comfort us, lead us and guide us. And as we come to you in silence, Lord, we ask that you would speak with us, that your spirit would commune with our spirits, and that we would become one. So very grateful for the fact that in Jesus Christ we are forgiven and set free from the bondage of sin and selfishness. We realize because of your word that as we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive them. And all the unrighteousness we have in our hearts will go away as we rest in you. This is truly amazing.
Thank you. Your word, O Lord, will last forever. It is eternal in heaven. Your faithfulness endures through all the ages. You have set the earth in place, and it remains. All things remain to this day because of your command, because they are all your servants. If your law had not been the source of my joy, I would have died for my sufferings. I will never neglect your instructions, because by them you have kept me alive.
Difficult, but And we not only that, but we did three programs at once, so that I didn't have to go in every week. And that was really hard. Then when I was at another church, they had a television ministry, and I had one simple part. I did a prayer. I was just a new minister, and I was not really that important. And they called it ad lib. The director was not a Christian, and but it was time, 45 seconds, no more. You had to get that done and get fired. Maybe not, but in any case, that was an interesting program. And then when I was in New York, we had our own program again. We had three TV cameras and all kinds of stuff. And everybody rehearsed, and we went through the program. It really went well. Now we're sitting here. We have a telephone with a camera, and we have some sound, which is okay in the building, but it doesn't always come through the camera, which has a limited range, and so it's a little different that way. And as we do these things, we don't always have a lot of time to rehearse, partially because people keep being added to our crew. We have the praise team, we have a new drummer, we have a new guitarist, we have just a wonderful time together, and we have somebody doing our taping who finds out at the last minute sometimes when he's supposed to be here. And then after it's taped, we have to quick transfer it to another media so that another person can put the words on the songs, which takes 3 or 4 hours. It's a long process, and get them ready. However, it's only going to happen one more week. Next week, we're going to be having services in the sanctuary, and we will be doing the entire service on video, and we'll be transferring it to the internet so people who can't come can watch. But we're encouraging everybody to come. Not this Sunday, we can only take 10, but a week from Sunday on the 14th is going to be the inauguration of a new format, and we hope everybody will be able to join us. Last week we talked about meditation and how important it is in the Christian life. And certainly as you watch television this past week, there was plenty to meditate on. I mean, every day, every night, it was the same story, rewritten a little bit, and new aspects. And there were people who were injured, and people whose property was damaged, and some people were killed. There were protests about what had happened to someone who had been murdered. And every broadcast began with a summary of where it was that day. And if you wanted to meditate on that, you could all week. It's sort of like cable TV insists that you think about the same subject 24 hours a day. And sometimes it's really important, but meditation isn't intended to be just on the negative and sad and tragic situations in our lives. What God wants us to meditate on is His involvement in our lives so that we can live through the tragedies and the heartaches and the sad situations and the unknown aspects of what we face in our lives and find hope. And the situation that most mirrors that for us as we live through the stages that are ending a pandemic shutdown, and as we watch riots going on because of the death of a person who was murdered by a policeman in our society, and as we watch looting and people being killed and hurt, We have something that boxes us in and gives us a kind of despair. And how do we live through it? And how does our country go through it? Well, it was a similar situation in Israel. Moses had died. The people of Israel had offended God when He brought them to the Promised Land with miracle after miracle after miracle, and they said they were afraid to go in because it was too dangerous. The entire Egyptian army had been chasing them. They had no weapons, and God had parted the Red Sea and let them go through on dry land, and then drowned all the Egyptians. When they were out of water, He provided it. When they were out of food, He provided it. When they were out of direction, He provided it. And when they got to the Promised Land, they said, "It's too dangerous." And He said, "If you're going to be that ungrateful, that disrespectful, that disobedient, then I'm not going to let you go in. And this generation is going to die before the people of Israel receive this land. Well, the Israelites slowly died over 40 years. And only the ones who had been faithful to God at the first encounter with the Promised Land were allowed to go in. But when they got to the Promised Land, Moses died. Moses was the leader. He's the one who led them through the Red Sea. He's the one who made the water come out of the rock, or at least was used by God to make it happen. He was the one who announced God's plan to provide food and all the rest. And he's dead. And Joshua's there as his protege, perhaps. I mean, there's no indication that that's totally the case, but Joshua was the most commonly thought of person, and he had led the Israelites into battle. So when they got to the Promised Land and Moses died, everybody looked to him, and he was a little uncertain about what he was supposed to do. And God came to him and said to Joshua these words in Joshua 1:7-9. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the instructions Moses gave you. Do not deviate from them, turning either to the right or to the left. Then you will be successful in everything you do. Study the book of instruction, that is the first 5 books of the Bible. Study the books of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night, so you will be sure to obey everything written in that book of instruction. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all you do. This is my command. Be strong and courageous. Don't be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. How'd you like God to say that to you? Guess what? He already has. These words are for us. We can say, well, they were written 3,500 years ago with a specific context to a specific person. And it's true, they were written to someone, but they were also written for God's people through the ages. He is the God who gives us courage. He is the God who helps us not be afraid. He is the God who's with us wherever we go. And if we'll meditate on what he's taught us, and if we'll think it through and believe it, it changes our perspective and it gives us hope whatever we face. And it doesn't matter what race you're a part of. It doesn't matter what era you're a part of. It doesn't matter what circumstance you're a part of. God is with us wherever we go. And if we put our faith and our trust in him, we can find hope for the future and life with him. But as we meditate on what he's taught us through Joshua, there are 4 things that we need to do. First, we need to read the scripture and actually read it. It's so easy for us to say, oh, I believe the Bible, I believe God, I believe all kinds of things. But unless we read his word, it doesn't get planted in us. We have to read it, and then we have to believe it. When God says, I'll be with you wherever you go, we've got to believe that so that when we go through a pandemic, when we're faced with tragedy, when our heart breaks because of what's going on around us, we know that he's with us wherever we go. Thirdly, we have to absorb scripture. We have to let it seep into our inner being so we can remember it, so we can be transformed by it, so it can be part of the reality of who we are. We're the ones with whom God is. He's with us. And then we have to apply it and obey it. We can apply scripture to our lives theoretically. We can read it, we can say, yeah, you know, I should be more faithful, I should be more confident, I should be more trusting, I should study God's word more and meditate on it. But unless we obey his teaching and actually do it, it doesn't make any difference. And what we're going to say today is, as we celebrate communion, we celebrate the fact that God's provided everything we need. He's given us a book of instruction. He's given us a book of direction. He's given us a book of encouragement and strength and hope and new life. And then, so that everybody can understand he's serious and able to do anything, He comes in the person of Jesus Christ and dies on the cross for our guilt and sin and shame, for our self-centered disobedience and disregard for him and other people. And he invites us to become his children forever. He invites us, when we're no people, to become his people. When we're living in darkness, to live in the light, as Peter put it in his letter. And we need to trust God in that way. So I invite you, as we celebrate communion today, to make this a time when you renew your commitment to God and you allow him to come into your heart and encourage you and take control of your thinking and be the one who defines what's important and how to deal with things and who is your neighbor and who you should have so much concern for. Let God work in your life and he'll give you the hope that's a part of his life in us. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word, and we ask that you would help us as we celebrate communion to apply that word to our hearts and to be changed. Take away our heart of stone and fill us with a heart of flesh, as Ezekiel put it in the Old Testament. Give us compassion and tender-heartedness towards those who suffer. Give us courage and confidence in the God who loves us when we suffer. Make us able to be your ambassadors wherever we go. We pray for the people around us in need. Those who mourn the loss of a man who, while he was doing something wrong, is a minor infraction, he was murdered by a police officer in Minneapolis. We pray for his family. We pray for the people who mourn his passing. At the same time, we pray for people who, in these past weeks, this past week of demonstrations and looting and violence, have lost their businesses and even their lives. And we ask that you would be with them too. And in the middle of it all, we have a pandemic, and there are people who caught the coronavirus this week. And there were 800 who died, and we haven't talked as much about them because we haven't had time. But they're real too. And besides them, there are thousands of other people who have died this week from other causes, and they probably, many of them, will go unnoticed. And there have been natural disasters. And there have been scandals revealed in Washington, as happens quite often. And there are people crying out to you, O Lord, from all over the world, to give them hope in the middle of all these problems and more. And we pray for them, and we ask that you would help us feel the compassion that you called us to and the tenderheartedness that you commanded us to. Help us to forgive those who offend us and to offend others less. We pray for those who put their lives in danger to take care of others. In the hospitals, on the streets, and in other ways. We pray for those who have family problems that are so big that they can't sleep at night. People have financial needs that are so real, they're not sure how they can stay in a home very long. We pray for those who are suffering from illness, whether the coronavirus or any of hundreds of other diseases. And we pray that you would help all of us to be grateful for the fact that you've spared us from many of these things. As we walk through the valley of the shadow of death ourselves at points, help us to trust you because we know that you love us and we know that you care for us. We pray for our president, our Congress, our courts, for the Justice Department, for all kinds of people, the police department, the fire department, doctors and nurses and teachers. People can't do what they are supposed to do. As we begin to open up our society, may we be drawn closer to you. For we pray all these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. In a moment, we're going to celebrate communion. And as we do that, obviously, you're going to have to provide the elements for your own celebration. You can use bread, you can use some substitute for it, you can use grape juice or wine or water. Jesus turned that into wine, and he can do it again. So we can simply use the symbols that represent his body and blood and renew our commitment to him as we celebrate the Lord's Supper together. In preparation, let's sing.